polarization, meaning the idea that if you can make everybody look at the same thing at the same time, that their rational mind will decrease and their emotional response will increase.
Let me talk to you.
For those of us that grew up immersed in the world of wrestling, wrestlers were our superheroes. They were larger than life characters that could fly shatter their bones and get back up. And even topple giants.
Today, look at this.
Lucky for those finding themselves where we once stood, that magic has never left the sport that we fell in love with all those years ago. The difference being is that we are no longer the target demographic. The enchantment from the product is for the generations following ours. Imagine yourself as a child at your first wrestling show. The music hits, the crowd roars, and Sean Ricker's character of L.A. Knight bursts onto the scene, electrifying the building. The atmosphere strikes you to your core, almost reverberating within your body. You are filled with anxiety and adrenaline. While attempting to understand this feeling, a sense of panic washes over you. Suddenly, you are forced back to reality from your temporary shock as you are lifted high into the air onto the shoulders of your guardian. Your eyes snap towards the blaring music and bright lights, and there, at the top of the entrance ramp, a superhero stands. At that moment, in that space and time, you have been captured by the man they call. It's important to discuss how we got the widely praised character of L.A. Knight. But if you're not a backstory type of person, feel free to skip directly to chapter 2. Sean Ricker began his wrestling career on the independent circuit in 2003. He joined Championship Wrestling from Hollywood in 2010 when the promotion was affiliated with the National Wrestling Alliance, aka the NWA. After leaving in 2013, he signed a developmental contract with WWE and performed in its then developmental territory, NXT, under the ring name Slate Randall. Arguably one of the worst names in developmental history. Slate Randall was then released in 2014. He signed with Impact Wrestling, formerly known and again currently known as TNA, the following year in 2015. Ricker would make a name for himself in his 4 years under the Impact banner with the name Eli Drake. During his time in Impact, he became a one-time Impact World Champion, one-time TNA King of the Mountain champion, and one-time Impact World Tag Team champion alongside Scott Steiner. He also won Impact's Feast or Fired briefcase twice. After leaving Impact in 2019, Ricker signed with the rebooted NWA, where he became a one-time NWA World Tag Team champion alongside James Storm. And for those that are keeping track at home, Ricker was now 16 years into his wrestling career. That is no small amount of time to invest into your craft without mainstream success. The next step of Ricker's ascension came in the form of another shot with NXT in 2021, 7 years after his initial release. This is where he was promptly named and began to hone in on the character of LA Knight. Then in 2022, Ricker found himself on the main roster under the name Max Dupree, where he led the group Maximum Male Models. He would betray the group a few months later and revert back to his LA Knight persona, reassuming the role of the modern megastar we all know today. Captivating, universal, remarkable. These are just a few of the words to describe the character work of L.A. Knight. Regardless of where you find yourself in the wrestling world, whether that be as a WWE purist, indie darling, or a forum rager, it's highly likely that L.A. Knight has captured your attention and been a topic that you have discussed. His very presence is eye-catching, and his message is delivered with intention and honesty that only the greats have mastered. The comedian Jimmy Carr once said,
"The two big ones for me is charm and charisma. People are either charming or charismatic. So, if they're like the big example."
This specific conversation may be pertaining directly to comedy. However, the act of capturing an audience is relevant in both art forms. For those of us that have studied wrestling over the years, you'll understand the phrase, charisma pays the bills. That phrase holds especially true within the circus that is the world of wrestling. Unfortunately for wrestlers pursuing their dreams, that aforementioned circus forces you to believe charisma can't be taught. You either have it or you don't. That idea goes hand in hand with this quote from a Players Tribune article by the icon Sting. "There's no faking it, not in this business." This is where a wrestler like Sean Ricker makes his money. But before we delve deeper into the stellar character that is L.A. Knight, it is necessary to view the criticisms of that same character. The following sentence is commonly used to slight and disparage Ricker's character work.
"He's a combination of The Rock and Stone Cold."
L.A. Knight's work is viewed with a jaded perspective because it's not wholly him. Yet, if you thumb through the pages of wrestling history, it's incredibly simple to shatter that perspective. The Young Bucks are a modern version of the Hardys in combination with Edge and Christian. FTR are Arn and Tully along with the Midnight Express. Darby Allin is Sting's spooky goth son. He goes as far as copying his cadence in promos and spends more time in the rafters than the average bat. Hell, two of the four faces on Wrestling Mount Rushmore, Ric Flair and Hulk Hogan, heavily borrow from superstar Billy Graham. Wrestling, like most sports, is a copycat system. Modern wrestlers study the previous generations under a microscope to figure out exactly what they can add to their own arsenal. If you are an athlete, your sports history should be studied with intent. It's standard practice. These studious efforts have led to an undeniable rise of what makes a great wrestler. The positive side of that conversation is the floor for being a great wrestler is higher than it has ever been before. The negative side of that conversation is the floor for being a great wrestler is higher than it has ever been before. The scrutiny that modern wrestlers face is tenfold that of previous wrestling generations. That same microscope that they use to identify their faults for the sake of improvement is a double-edged sword. Vitriolic consumers of the product will latch on to any bit of information that fits their narrative and run with it. Past wrestlers, for better or worse, came face to face with the audience that despised them. Modern wrestlers get thrashed and abused by the internet masses, leaving these wrestlers with quite an awful case of pick your poison. The case against dealing with modern wrestling critics is that those aforementioned internet troglodytes or consumers denounce any newer iteration of the product they once knew. They feel a sense of entitlement towards what they deem to be the best era of wrestling and their wrestlers. Simply put, it's easy for people to become disgruntled with things they don't understand. The counterpoint to that is, if it worked for every wrestler to borrow from legendary gimmicks, every wrestler would do it. Look at Sharkboy, TNA's version of Stone Cold Steve Austin, if he were a shark. There are clear-cut cases of wrestlers stealing gimmicks down to the thread, and it's still not working. Would that mean that people are spiteful towards LA Knight because he capitalized in such a way that nobody else could? It's not rhetorical. It's a genuine question. LA Knight's character is a revival of everything cool about the Attitude Era. We should probably clarify that that removes all the sex abuse and racism. He's a revival in the sense that he's just cool, in the purest form of the word. He looks cool, he acts cool, and he has a damn good control of the audience. Sean Ricker understands his character. He knows that his job is to captivate that audience. He is trying to make them believe. It's often said that the most important tool a wrestler can have is to make an audience believe. Believe in their character, believe in the match, or believe in what is being said. And if that is part and parcel of what truly makes a wrestler sensational, then look no further than Sean Ricker's character of L.A. Knight. Regardless of what platform you find yourself watching on, go ahead and support, please. Like the video, subscribe. It helps a ton. Also, I'm starting to stream just about every day on twitch.tv/NobleHamill and youtube.com/C/NobleHamill. Come say hey and join in on the live experience. Maybe we'll do wrestling watch-alongs sooner rather than later. Anyway, back to the video. To those that have watched my wrestling videos before, you'll know that I believe in three fundamental rules for what makes a great wrestler. In-ring ability, promo, and character work. LA Knight isn't going to chain wrestle like the excellent Zack Sabre Jr., tell a story like Will Ospreay and Kenny Omega, or suspend disbelief like Jerry Lawler. LA Knight is not great in the wrestling context of the squared circle. In fact, he's just fine. That may cause issues for those self-proclaimed wrestling purists that need a five-star match to get behind a champion, but if you're only entertained by one aspect of the product, maybe it's time to get a different hobby. People don't tune into LA Knight segments because they can't wait to see him wrestle. They want to see what he does with a microphone in his hand. Additionally, the magic of LA Knight isn't for the older generations. Don't get me wrong, he'll drop a joke now and again that will only register for an adult audience in the same way SpongeBob would leave in certain jokes for the parents that watched along.
Look, doubloons! Don't drop them!
LA Knight's time on TV is best viewed when he has something to say. And boy, does he have a lot to say. Did you really think we'd go this whole video without dissecting an LA Knight promo? The following segment is from an episode of Raw on August 7th, 2023, featuring LA Knight and The Miz. Immediately, we are met with a clear face and heel within seconds of interacting. The crowd knows who to root for.
No.
Miz immediately turns up the heat with a promo that works inside and outside of kayfabe.
You don't think I've seen superstars like you come in here, come into WWE, try to ride my coattails? See, the way I see it...
Using such terminology as a flash in the pan or flavor of the month.
You are a flash in the pan. You are a flavor of the month. Now, don't get me wrong.
LA Knight opens with such buzzwords as honesty and trust. He chooses his verbiage carefully as to deliver a message with intent.
Let me be honest. I don't have a problem with you. But trust me when I say you do not want to make this personal.
Personal? You want to talk personal? It's been personal. I take my career very, very personal. I've taken it personal for 20 years.
When the flow of the promo bounces back towards The Miz, he turns into an extremely annoying heel, but again, is speaking some truths.
I have main evented WrestleMania. I am a two-time Grand Slam champion. I have made myself indestructible to anyone in that locker room. Anything they give me out here for 20 years. What have you done for the past 20 years?
During this process, he neither buries himself or his opponent. Then he sets up Knight perfectly with a what have you done in the past 20 years.
What have I been doing for the last 20 years? That's a great question. You know what I've been doing? I've been making myself a dangerous man. What does that mean? I'll tell you what that means. I've been clawing, scratching, doing everything I needed to do. On the outside, looking in, while this place bet on all the wrong horses, you being one of them.
He mentions that he's a dangerous man, that he's been clawing and scratching doing everything he needed to do, which could pertain to the fact he had been a journeyman for the last 20 years, or it could go even deeper towards the man that was supporting himself with work at a lumber mill and a Ruby Tuesday restaurant.
You got that 20-year head start because you're safe.
He then follows up by using the term safe to call Miz a pushover. Knight then directs those same words back towards himself, saying he didn't get the same chance because he's a dangerous man.
Spin, we're not ready to take the chance on you yet. You know why? Because I'm a dangerous man.
Knight looks like a babyface that'll put his money where his mouth is. Miz looks like a classic cowardly heel. It's phenomenal work from both men. If we get into what makes a great world champion in the WWE, there are a few key pieces of criteria. You have to look great, you have to be able to talk, and you have to be a draw. The purpose of a wrestler like LA Knight isn't to get somebody like myself, who has been watching wrestling for almost 20 years, to buy his merchandise or believe his story. LA Knight isn't for me. He's a part of the next generation of superheroes. I had mentioned before to put yourself in your childhood shoes. Do so again. Imagine yourself in the crowd watching this boisterous, 6 foot tall, 240 pound, larger than life character taking on all the bad guys and looking cool as can be in the process. That feeling burning deep in your chest is the same thing that got you and I into wrestling as kids. It's the same feeling when Stone Cold's music hits. It's the same feeling when Ric Flair's hit. It's the same feeling that Tony Schiavone gets whenever Sting's music would hit. The only difference now is that instead of the what's, woos, and iconic Sting screams, we got everybody saying. I like saving my personal thoughts for the end of the video. It's a cool little transparent conversation that we can have. I'm going to keep doing my best to make these videos better and better for y'all. The reason they take so long is because I'm a bit of a perfectionist. Put simply, I think y'all deserve great videos, and if what I'm making isn't up to my own standard, then it needs more time on the easel. Also, some might find it interesting that I don't necessarily like LA Knight's work, but that doesn't mean I don't appreciate it. It'd be pretty darn silly to shield my eyes from great character work just because he doesn't compare to my personal favorites. And regardless of who your favorites are, just have fun with the product. Anyway, what should I make a video about next? A series on the greatest tag teams of all time? The best wrestler on the planet? The best stable on TV? The best female gimmick, if not the best gimmick in AEW? Or maybe we hit another genre switch? Anyway, I'll hopefully see you guys soon. Bye, have a wonderful time.